This time on Norfolk Perspectives, we're going to go behind the scenes with Crime Line and talk about their oyster roast coming up. We got a maker fair coming up, and you're going to want to really see this. It's cool stuff. St. Mary's Fall Mile for Movement Festival. And Stormwater has in-school field trips that are free. Stay tuned for a great demonstration and great talk right here on Norfolk Perspectives. Welcome to Norfolk Perspectives. I'm Bob Batcher, and I'm joined by Phil Davenport for the Norfolk Crime Line Board President. So you're in charge. You're the big kahuna.
Well, thank you for having me, Bob.
Cool. It's good to have you here. Okay, let's set the record straight. Who is Crime Line?
Crime Line is a group of concerned citizens that raise money to pay for the tips that we get into Norfolk Crime Line. We don't get any public money, so we have to raise it all ourselves.
Okay, so you're not police officers, you're not part of the judicial system, it's a third party.
It's a third party, we're just private citizens, just like you.
Okay, now I promised in the pre-tease that we were gonna go behind the scenes. So tell me, how's it work then?
All right, well, the tips come in on the 888 lock you up number, or they come in by text tipping, or you can go to our website, www.norfolkcrimeline.com, and you can put a tip in there. They come into the dispatchers, and the 888 number might be a Virginia Beach crime or Norfolk crime. They route it to the appropriate city. The text tips go right to the police department, and as do the web tips. And they investigate the crimes, get the criminals off the street, and when they do, the tips are rewarded.
Okay, now I'm gonna expose myself that I have never called in a tip, so I don't know how it works. But I mean, how do you keep it confidential?
Well, all the tips that come in through the phone line and through the website and through the text tipping is all encrypted. So the police department doesn't get to find out who you are by their caller ID, and the cell phone is all encrypted. They don't know anything. It's all kept confidential. You never have to testify. You never called into court. They can't subpoena you. It'll never happen.
Okay, now, so where does the need for money come in?
Well, we pay the rewards in cash.
Oh, okay.
We put it at a secure location, they go there with a code word, pick it up, and it happens.
And it's done.
It's done.
Now, but the cost of the phone line, things like that too? You have administrative costs?
Well, those costs are kind of covered by a regional fundraising. We have the Top Cop every year, and that's in November. It's on November 2nd this year. That raises enough money to pay for the 888 lock you up number and the text tip software. And there's a little bit of proceeds that come back to the program. But that's all private money also. Nothing comes from the city, state, or federal government. So we also have to raise local money to pay the crimes in Norfolk. That's why we have an oyster roast.
Gotcha. And I got to say that the Top Cop dinner is something that the police officers really look forward to. It means a lot. So you're kind of doing a double duty. You're recognizing their public safety officers, but
that's
then also
correct.
raising funds.
Each city puts up their best officer of the year, and they select one to be the top cop in the area, and there's recognition that goes along with that.
Now, by the way, Phil, I introduced you as the big kahuna of the president, but you're not paid either.
No. No one on our board is paid. We're all private citizens. It's all volunteer board, and we work hard to raise money. We gave over $22,000 in cash last year, so we have to raise that money every year to keep the program going.
Okay.
We've
now,
been
I've heard
over 30 years.
Wow. 30 years?
Over 30 years.
That's awesome. And that really kind of came out of the police chief from Norfolk,
yeah,
right?
Chief Grant back in 1981, after hearing about this from a crime in New Mexico, wanted to bring that program to Norfolk, got a group of citizens together, and got it working. It's been working ever since.
It's been working so much, you got to have the second fundraiser. And I understand on good authority, you know a good oyster.
Yes, I do.
So, come
October 12th.
All right. Where's it going to be?
It's going to be at the Knights of Columbus Hall here on Government Avenue in Norfolk.
That's guaranteed fun.
Guaranteed fun. Absolutely. We'll have all the oysters steamed up, ready to go. You can eat them raw if you'd like. We're going to have barbecue for the non-oyster eaters. Have a little entertainment out there. Have the kids under 10 get in free. Get your tickets in advance for $35. You can call me, email me, and we'll hook you up with tickets.
So how many people are you hoping to get?
We're hoping, this is our inaugural event. We're hoping to get at least 200. So anything over 200, we'll really be happy.
That ought to be a piece of cake. So it's October 12th from 2 to 5.
2 to 5.
Now, are you sure about this kids under 10? Because I've seen some 10-year-olds put down some oysters.
Oh, we'll have some fun things for the kids to do. And they'll eat some barbecue and some coleslaw and baked beans and some other things. So Yeah, they won't eat all the oysters. Some of the grown-ups will push them out of the way.
There we go. So what's the website that somebody can go to?
It's www.norfolkcrimeline.com is our website. We have a brochure on there. You also can email me, phil@bceva.com, or you can call me at 536-8437.
You know, Phil, we in Norfolk now, we're really working on trying to get our viewers and our residents engaged in making a difference and finding a solution. I got to say, your board is a great example of that, where they were able to watch something 30 years ago and say, wait a minute, we need to do something about it. So thanks for everything that you guys
Thank you very much, Bob.
Okay, when we come back, we're going to be talking about a maker fair and the role you can play in finding out a whole new way of doing business. Stay tuned. Welcome back to Norfolk Perspective. Well, have you ever flown and you've been in that Sky Mall magazine and you see all this high-tech, great stuff? Well, you know what? It may have started as a toy, right? I am so overloaded with new information, I hope to share it with you, but we have a maker fair coming right here in Norfolk with some very creative minds, to the point you guys don't really even know what's going to happen at the maker fair,
it's
right?
It's pretty much the greatest show and tell right in the area.
I'm just on overload, but we got to make some TV here. So Paul Chin?
Yeah, Paul Chin Jr.
And you're part of this?
I have a really big passion for the maker community. I think that as a creative myself, I want to get as many people involved in showing just what's inside their brain, like out and on the table.
Okay, so what part of your brain is on this table?
What I do is I tell people about it. I make photos, I make videos. And if you go on our YouTube channel for Hampton Roads Maker Faire, you can see videos of other makers and kind of what they've done.
And are they all on arm's length away?
Not quite. Okay. They're a little bit better than that.
Cool. Bo Turner?
Absolutely.
Okay, what part of your brain is on this table?
Pretty much everything you see inside
of here. Well, this is what's happening inside
that
head?
These are pieces. So sometimes it's ideas that someone else takes. Sometimes it's you taking and adding pieces to that and giving back. And I also started the 757 Makerspace right here in Norfolk.
Okay, and it's really kind of taking what's inside your head and creating and then... Not necessarily for a patent, right?
Yeah, if you can imagine it, you can make it. Sometimes it's simple as it really is, in a fantastic way, in that if you have an idea in that morning, by lunchtime, you can have that piece prototyped and made and have a physical piece, whether it's something like this magnifying glass here on the table for taking an iPhone and doing macro photography. Now you can see the water beat up inside of a plant or the pollen inside of there on a bee, to larger pieces. If you want to use the 3D printer, laser cutters, CNC machines, and from there, the world's your oyster.
Okay, now this thing. I've been to the space camp in Alabama, and they had this thing where they had a mold, and they mm-hmm. plastic went in it, and voila, for $1.50, I had a... That's not this, though, is it?
So that's probably about 10 cents the material that you're looking at right there.
Really?
And built on this machine right here, and what happens is, it's kind of like the frosting on a cake. You know, it's kind of comes out, you got this material, it's ABS, same stuff that Lego bricks made of.
ABS means?
ABS is just a type of plastic. Same stuff that Lego bricks. So this piece is solid, strong. And you can build and prototype right with that.
Now, this is what I've heard in the news is 3D printer?
Correct.
Now it makes sense.
This is it. Pretty
solid.
So this
could be an ear.
It with biomaterial, and it could be an edible if you'd replace it with chocolate.
Ooh, the chocolate.
We take a few pictures
Anything
of you.
Anything inside your head.
Take a few pictures of you, and we can actually have your head as an ice.
You wouldn't want it. Okay, Richard Mormon, you've brought a magazine that reminded me as when I was a kid, I used to drool over Scientific America, but this is the new thing coming.
It is. This is a recent edition of Make Magazine, and that's really the inspiration for this event. It was started by the company that publishes Make, and it's the maker movement, and that's what Bo's talking about here. It's this whole movement. It's not... You don't have to have $1 million to go build a prototype. If you've got a concept, Bo can make it in a day. And this is, it talks about manufacturing, and there's a business motive there. But what this gets to for me, and you almost said it, I heard you, awesome. If you show up at the Maker Faire, you see some awesome. If you talk to anybody who goes to Maker Faire, all they say is awesome. We all said it last year. We're going to say it again this year. We're going to say it for the next month until the event comes. Because it is awesome. Prime example, if you built an electric car, I want to have an electric car. I don't know about you, but I hope my kid's first car is actually an electric car.
Right.
Not a hybrid, a pure electric, because, you know, it's just wonderful to have an electric car. I found a guy in North Carolina. He drove 6 hours to attend our fair last year, and he showed off this hot rod he made. And it's got, I mean, it's almost like 1.21 gigawatts of power, but it's actually 220 volts DC, which is a lot of power to put in a vehicle. And the Maker Faire gives us an opportunity to showcase things like that. This guy's an inventor, yes, but really what we want to pull out is our local citizens here in Norfolk who may have one of these electric cars in their garage and we don't know about it.
Right.
We want to meet that guy because there's probably another guy on the other side of town who's also enthusiastic about electric cars. And we want to get these two guys together. Next thing you know, maybe we'll start a club. And after that, where will it lead? I don't know. But I'm looking forward to the day when there's a lot of electric vehicles driving around downtown Norfolk. And the problem isn't parking, it's who's got the electric charger
right.
that I can park next to. I mean, that's where I think this is going to go. I mean, obviously, there's some toys here. We're also looking at our children. Our kids, you and I, we played with Legos mm-hmm. and Erector sets and Tinker Toys. Our kids are stuck to a screen most of the time. This is tactile. They touch. They pull these things apart. In the video, you may have seen the giant puzzle pieces that were getting put together right. at the event. They're coming back this year. Kids just show up, and we don't tell them what to do. We just dump the parts in the middle of the floor, and they start building things. And we want to promote that.
Now, and it's a matter of I used the term toy when you first started setting up, and I was pleased that you reinforced that. Because it's not necessarily just playthings, because in that plaything, I'm looking at the way these things interact with each other. You can kind of, by taking them apart and putting them back together.
It's actually a gear. Just twist two of the corners across from each other.
Oh, okay.
At the same time.
They interact.
That is cool.
What I find really interesting about the maker community is just how varied people can get with their creations. In going around and doing these interviews with people, I've met people who make glass beads with a torch. I've met people that work on a wood lathe turning wood. I've met people who make robotics. I've met people who make Star Wars armor. Met people who make real armor. I've met people, like all kinds of folks that are part of this maker movement that Rich was talking about. And it's just very exciting to have everybody here in a single place.
So for that person who just came in from the garage tinkering, come on over on October 19th to Scope and tinker there. Is that what you're saying?
Actually, before then, if you're a maker and you've got something that you'd like to show off and tell people about this, sign up right now to be part of the Maker Faire. Have an opportunity to do that.
Right, because we need people to come and show what they know as well as to come attend and be inspired. So it's twofold, and it costs nothing.
Wait, what did you just say?
It costs nothing.
Free.
Free.
All right.
Some great sponsors. The city of Norfolk has been a sponsor this year, and some of our local industries and schools are becoming very involved in what we're trying to do here. So it's really a community-driven event, and we're looking for the community to participate as makers and then just come on out, bring your kids. It's entirely family-friendly.
Well, I'm really excited. And this little guy, you won't miss. Thanks a lot for joining me. I'll put it back. Thanks for joining us. And talk about inspiration. St. Mary's is coming up, and they are an inspiration. Stay tuned.
Oh, hey, Mark.
Hey, Mark.
Hey.
Where have you been?
I lost my cat.
Oh, that's not right.
Yeah, so I made this cat magnet to try and get him back.
Cool. Does it work?
Kinda.
Nice.
Yeah, but that's not my cat. Gotta keep working on it. See ya.
See ya.
Anything's possible. Keep thinking. Get started on your own inventions or just play some games at inventnow.org.
Welcome back to Norfolk Perspective. Wow, I'm worn out from all that creativity and play, but we got some great guests right here. Mary Helen Hilton from St. Mary's Home, Director of Annual Giving. How you doing?
I'm fine, Bob.
Talk about a special place. Amy Dagno, you're an auxiliary board mm-hmm. member. I know you from all kinds of other places,
yes.
So let me ask you one simple reason. Why are you involved with St. Mary's?
For me, it was very personal because my best friend's son lived there for a good number of years. He was born profoundly disabled. And once they weren't able to take care of him at home, he went to St. Mary's, and everybody realized, what an amazing place it is, and just can't leave it now.
Yeah, it is. It is. You know, Mary, I was commenting about the name of the event because it's a fall home. Wait a minute. It's Fall Mile for Movement Festival. It's a mouthful. But I really plugged in on the idea of movement because I know my first experience with St. Mary's taught me a whole new meaning of what Life Celebrated Daily means. And sometimes with some of your residents, just a glimmer in the eye is celebrating life, right?
Absolutely.
So for some, a simple movement is very significant. Mm-hmm. But where did this title come from?
Well, the title, we're actually blending two events. So this is the first time we're doing this type of event, Bob, and we're lucky that we have our friends at Portfolio Recovery are sponsoring us. But what we've done for the past few years is we've done a fall festival at St. Mary's for just our families. And we're opening it up to the community this year, and we're incorporating something that we did a couple years ago called Mile for Movement. And Mile for Movement was a mile walk around our campus.
I think I could handle that as part of my fitness program.
So we want to get you out there. That idea came from something that Amy's going to share with us. That was Bailey Widman's piece in it, and we're bringing that back. And so I'll let you, Amy, share a little bit about that Mile for Movement.
Well, my friend's son, Christopher, who lived there, his little sister, Bailey, she was a senior in high school a few years ago and had to do a senior project. And she wanted to do something for St. Mary's because even though she wasn't a resident, she grew up there. And mm-hmm. her heart belonged there. And even though her brother isn't with us anymore, she feels that connection. So her project was Mile for Movement. And it was called that because back then they were raising money for a special piece of equipment to help kids move better. And the whole thing is to keep them moving, keep them active, plus get the community involved, get to know St. Mary's, get some exercise in. And we knew immediately with the turnout and the kids from the home participating that this was going to be good.
You know, you guys are going through all kinds of changes now with the new wing. Just got opened up, which allows you to spend some more time with some very special people, right?
Yes, transitioning had always been really difficult for us. And so now we're able to just transition right there. And it's just such a blessing to families to be able to have that comfort of knowing that they're going to move right on over.
And I think that's something I'm sensing on October 5th is the festival and the Mile
for Movement and Fall Festival.
So, but it's also, I mean, the creation of it really was to provide some hope for the families through the festival.
Well, and really we want the community to come and enjoy mm-hmm. what our families have enjoyed. So we've got the festival that's going on from 10 to 2. The mile is part of that. That'll take place at 11 o'clock. And one thing that was really wonderful about the time that we had the Mile for Movement when Bailey led that effort was, 90% of our kids got out and participated in it. Whereas before, when we had the 5K different places, we tried to get as many kids as we could there, but transportation made it kind of difficult to maximize that number. But everybody was out enjoying that walk around our campus.
Here's the $64,000 question. You're driving down 64. I've been watching the construction and see the sign, St. Mary's. How in the world do you get there, though?
It's easy.
Okay.
You can go from two different directions. I come from the boulevard and turn on Kempsville Road, just across the street from Sentara Lee Hospital.
Okay.
And then you turn on Kempsville Circle. You come a different way, don't you?
Yeah, I just come right off of 64. You take Newtown Road exit, and then off of Newtown, just take a right on Kempsville, and we'll ride across from Sentara Lee.
And if you haven't been there, you gotta go, because it's an awesome, awesome place where people really feel like they're the center of the neighborhood. And that's what I really like about it.
St. Mary's is a really wonderful place, and the employees, they're not just employees.
No.
They're family members, and you see how they love the children, and it's so nice when the community can join in and enjoy that too.
Well, I think it's really neat because we talk resident, not patient.
Right.
Yeah. And I'm continually touched by, I did a presentation just last week where a family member said he'd grown up in this area and knew about St. Mary's, but until he recently had his son come there, he didn't realize what a home it really was.
Yes. Thank you. Well, thanks. And come on out October 5th from 10 to 2. I'll be there. We'll do the mile. That sounds good. Hey, when we come back, we're going to have a demonstration with stormwater, so I don't know if that means I'm going to get wet or not. Find out when we come back.
Now, come on. Come on. Come on.
All right. I know. 2 seconds. Hang on. Just stand still. Stand still.
This is
insane.
Just
one second. I know. Just
come on.
Okay, go, go, go. Woo!
No. Boys, hang on, boys!
You don't have to be perfect to be a perfect parent. There are thousands of children in foster care who will take you just as you are.
Welcome back to Norfolk Perspectives. I got Fleeta Jackson here. I never know quite what's going. They said it was a demo, so I'm ready to get wet. Am I going to get wet? Stormwater.
I didn't water. Bring water.
Oh, you didn't bring water?
I didn't.
What is all this?
This is what I use for my free in-school field trips with Norfolk schools.
Okay, so you're infiltrating, and I'm using that word for a reason.
You are.
Because having been a parent, what we wanted to let the viewer know is be prepared for your third grader to come home with knowledge.
That's what I'm hoping. That's what we're all about. These programs are set up to match the SOLs that the students are currently learning. October is Watershed for fourth graders. That's the program I started with. I had some really great mentors when I started with the city at Jaycox Elementary and Oceaneer Elementary School, tapped into some teachers I knew from way back when, and they told me about a need for watershed education. So I got this model that you see in the middle here. It is a watershed. It is a model of everything a watershed has in it.
Okay, so if this is in Binghamton, New York, and this is whatever that river is there,
right,
it ultimately could flow down to our place on the Chesapeake Bay. Is that?
Well, we are part of the Chesapeake Bay watershed.
Yeah.
And we do cover
six states.
You're not
going to say that's really smart, Bob?
That is really smart, Bob.
Thank you.
It is really smart. Six states, you're right, 64,000 square miles.
But this is really about my house.
It is.
In Suburban Park.
It is about your house and my house and the school and the factories. We don't have a lot of farms, but our watershed that drains from the Pennsylvania and the western part of Virginia, they have farms. So we have all that. We have mountains. The Appalachian Mountains are in our watershed. So right now it looks really nice and clean and pretty.
Mm-hmm.
But we know that that's not the reality. We know that there are things like motor oil dripping from cars.
Ooh.
We also know that people aren't always responsible with their pets, Bob.
Now, wait a minute. Now, okay, let's talk about that, because the last time you were on, I am a River Star home.
You are a River Star home.
And she almost took it away from me.
Because you didn't scoop the poop.
Well, but okay, but here's my house way over here. There's the water way over there. Come on.
And when it rains, where
yeah.
does it go?
Well, it kind of comes down here.
Down here, and right here. I know you can't see it. This is a storm drain.
Okay. Oh.
And this right here is one of those infamous outfalls that we have a lot in Ocean View.
Yeah.
They're usually black.
Yeah.
So from here to here is a direct line to, if we imagine, this is our Chesapeake Bay.
Oh.
This could be the Elizabeth
River, the
Lafayette.
So Sophie
River,
is messing up the Chesapeake Bay.
It gets there. It does make its
so
way.
So I do have to do the responsible thing.
You do. I should move my bridge back.
Yeah, that would be helpful.
All right.
Streets
so
and bridges would appreciate it.
They would appreciate that. So this is a great experiment. We do pollute it with pet waste. We use sprinkles for litter. I put on fertilizer because fertilizer is a big deal to pollute our waterways. There's sediment. So this construction site here, all this dirt has to be contained. We don't want it washing down the street and getting into our waterways.
Okay, so, well, here's the one then. I mow my yard.
Okay.
I let it mulch in the yard, so it's good for the yard.
That's great.
So why can't I blow the stuff in the street?
Well, number one, it clogs up those storm drains.
Oh.
So even if we weren't going to talk about the water quality issue that debris puts into the water,
yeah.
In Norfolk, we probably do not want our storm drains to ever get clogged.
Because it will cause that
water
to
not
flood.
To flow out of your yard.
Gotcha.
Yes. So we want to keep those storm drains clear. We want to keep the waterways clean. So the best way to do that is to keep all that mulch in your yard or bag what you don't use and put it out on trash day, and waste management will pick it up.
And this is the kind of stuff that you're going to be taking into the school.
Exactly, and it's all free. I have programs. The aquarium okay. on this yeah. side is Fred the Fish. It's There's one of my favorite stories.
But Fred the Fish has no water.
Well, I told you I didn't bring water today.
Okay.
But Fred is made out of a sponge.
Oh.
And you can take him out if you want. He's a little puppet fish, a marionette fish. He goes on a story. He goes on a journey to the Chesapeake Bay. So it's a story, and he encounters a lot of things along the way. The first thing that happens to Fred
It may be third grade,
no, that's
safe,
a kindergarten.
But not host.
That's
oh, this
a
is
kindergarten.
Kindergarten
story. So the first thing that happens to Fred is that he goes to a construction site. And that construction site throws dirt and rocks on Fred's head.
Oh.
That's the way his vacation starts.
Sounds like mine.
After that, he's going into a neighborhood, and they overfertilize their yard. So you get an idea about what Fred's vacation's really like, and I will give you a hint that he doesn't necessarily stay white at the end of the story. So it's a great story for the younger students. It's good for pollution. We talk about recycling, and so it fits all with their SOLs.
You're not going to finish the story?
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, we're out of time.
I think we're out of time.
So if you've got a Norfolk Public School student, they're going to be coming home with this.
I hope so. I'd love to be in every school in the city. We also do after-school club programs for middle and high schools.
And if your kid is a kindergartner, find out what happened to Fred. I want to know. Okay? Thanks
right.
a lot for really sharing a very important message. I kind of was fun with you, but I know that you've got me straight and Sophie's taking care of herself.
That's right. Well,
actually,
thank you.
Her owner is. Right. We want to hear from you what you'd like to see on TV 48, but more importantly, what's going on in your neighborhood. Give us a holler at 664-6510. And as usual, it's a wonderful time to be in Norfolk just because of you and you. Thanks a lot.